Hello everybody and welcome to video number 12 of the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. My name is Alf, this is a YouTube channel called Der Plasma and today is Sunday. We are in chapter 2, magnetic field configurations, and you might remember in the last video we started to talk about the stellarator and how we achieve a twisted magnetic field line in a stellarator. We will continue to talk about the stellarator in this video. And as a reminder, I'd like to distinguish the classical stellarator and the heliotron-torsatron, something which we did in one of the very first videos, but it's definitely worth to be repeated here since this is an important differentiation. So on the left-hand side, we see a drawing of the classical stellarator. This is the classical stellarator. On the right-hand side, this is a drawing of the heliotron, or also called torsatron. Torsatron, and in the case of the classical stellarator, you can see here the helical coils winding around the torus. 1, 2, and then here we have 3, and here another one, 4. And the current in the helical coils flows anti-parallel with respect to each other. So the helical currents are flowing anti-parallel with respect to each other. In the heliotron or torsatron, on the other hand, you can see here the helical coils winding around the torus. These are 2 coils in this case here, right? And in this case, the helical currents are flowing parallel. So here we have the helical currents flowing parallel with respect to each other. Now, you can see that in the case of the classical stellarator, we have additional toroidal field coils depicted in blue in the drawing, and these are required due to the fact that the helical currents are flowing antiparallel. So in the classical stellarator, additional toroidal field coils are required. Additional is written differently, I guess. Additional toroidal field coils are required, as we discussed. In the heliotron or torsatron, instead, additional vertical field coils are required. You might see it in the drawing above. These are the green colored coils, and these are the ones which are required here. So additional, this time I've written it correctly, additional vertical field coils are required. Okay, let's take a further look at the difference between these two types. So here you can see 2 drawings. On the left hand side, a classical stellarator. On the right hand side, again, heliotron or torsatron. And in green, you can see the coils, the current flowing, well, the coils and the current flowing in the coils. The left hand side, you have currents flowing anti-parallel in the helical coils. See these arrows here depicting it. And the additional toroidal field coils which are required. So these ones. And on the right-hand side, you can see in the case of the heliotron or torsatron, current flowing in one direction and the additional vertical field coils which are required for that. So to quantify the periodicity of stellarator and torsatron, we introduce small numbers, or it's quantified by small numbers. Small L is used to quantify the poloidal periodicity, so of symmetry, so the poloidal symmetry of the magnetic field. So basically, the number of periods into that direction, the periodicity in the poloidal direction, is usually denoted with a small l, and a small m is used for the toroidal symmetry of the magnetic field. So for the periodicity into the toroidal direction, for the number of periods in the toroidal direction. And in the example above, in the pictures above, there on the left hand side, first of all, it's a 3-fold symmetry in the poloidal direction. And in the classic accelerator, this requires obviously apparently 2 times L, meaning 6 helical windings. 6 helical windings in the case of the, or let's say at the classical stellarator, at classical stellarator, whereas in the case of the heliotron or torsatron, it only requires L equals to 3 helical windings, at the heliotron or torsatron. Torsatron. So an example for a classical stellarator was the original Wendelstein series, for example. An example for a heliotron is LHD, the Large Helical Device, which is a very large stellarator in Japan. It was the largest stellarator for a long time until W7X came into operation. And heliotrons are actually a bit easier to build because you have fewer coils and thus also reduced forces between these coils. But you're kind of less flexible with your magnetic field configuration. Okay, let's have a look at the resulting shape of the flux surfaces. So the magnetic field in stellarators consists basically of multipole fields. These are depicted on the left-hand side. So we see three different structures, three different symmetries, or three different multipole fields if you want. And as I've said, the magnetic fields in stellarators consists of multipole fields which are generated by currents by the helical currents or currents in the helical coils in the helical coils. And the shape of the multipole fields, the multipole fields, the structure of that reflects in the shape of the flux surfaces. So the multipole fields, the configuration of the multipole fields, or the structure, reflects in the shape of the flux surfaces. You can see three examples. On the left-hand side, an L equals 1 stellarator, and the center, an L equals 2 and L equals 3. And you see this type of symmetry when you go around poloidally in these cases. An important thing to be note is when you are bending or when you are deviating from the linear stellarator, which might be useful to describe it analytically, but when you bend the linear stellarator into a torus, what you eventually have to do to describe it properly, then a few things are happening. First of all, there is a loss of the helical symmetry. So you lose your helical symmetry. Loss of helical symmetry. And that means that the proof of existence for flux surfaces is no longer analytically possible, as we discussed. So that means the proof of existence for flux surfaces is no longer possible. Meaning, to check for the existence of flux surfaces, we have to do something like a Poincaré plot. It's no longer possible. Well, analytically, of course, I meant by that. Analytically. And this is why we have to prove or check for the existence of flux surfaces differently. And as I explained, a Poincaré plot is usually used for that. Either numerically or experimentally, because you can, of course, also check that in the experiment. Okay, a very important aspect in stellarators are the helical coils, which are actually hard to build. So, helical, sorry, a bit hard to read. Helical coils in Classical Stellarator. Sorry. I have a problem with my hand this morning. Stellarators or heliotrons are hard to build. And they are hard to build because when you think of the high field side, the coils can be very close together, but they cannot overlap, so to say, right? And then you have to build the helical coils inside of the toroidal coils, and this can be very annoying. And so this is why a few years ago somebody, the community came up with a very interesting approach. These are modular coils. So let's first, or to understand that, let's draw, make a drawing where we unfold the coils. So here we have the toroidal, the poloidal direction. So this is the poloidal direction. Here we have the toroidal direction. And now we are first looking at the toroidal coils in this example. So let's assume, since the toroidal coils obviously are just going in the toroidal direction, right? Like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then down like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then like this. And another one. 1, 2, 3, 4, down like this. And the current flows, of course, in these coils everywhere in the same direction, like this, for example, like this. And let's now have a look at the helical coils in such a stellarator. If we unfold in this plot where we unfold the toroidal and the poloidal direction, it looks, for example, like this, and then 1, 2, 3, like this, for example, and then 1, 2, 3, like this, and then another one, and another helical coil. And another helical coil. And since we have, here is the example, we take a look at the example of a classical stellarator, meaning the current flows, for example, here in this direction, then here in this direction, in this direction, in this direction, this direction, and in this direction. Now what we want to do is we want to replace this these classical concept with modular coils. So replace with, or by probably, so quite proposition. Replace by, or with, I don't know, with, by modular coils. And this would look, for example, like this. We would just try to get the same current path, meaning you would need a coil which is flowing, where the current is flowing like this, and then like this. And then we need another coil where the current flows like this, down, up, like this. And then another coil where the current flows like this, up, down, dip. And then again, current flowing like this, this. And these are the modular coils, yeah? So yellow are the modular coils, and that was a very important, a very big breakthrough in stellarator research. So that was a big breakthrough in stellarator research. So and the first example for that was W7AS, the advanced stellarator. So the advanced concept basically means to use modular coils, which allows for more flexibility. It's easier to build, so that was really an important thing. Okay, what else is important in stellarator research? There are a few things, and one is of particular importance, so very important in stellarator research is the optimization of the configurations, for symmetry. This really is an important topic. I will explain you why that is the case in a minute. The optimization of configurations for symmetry. Okay. It is important because, to make it simple, we know from the Noether theorem the very general property that symmetry implies conservation laws. So symmetry implies conservation laws. This is something very important. And here for our magnetic fusion device, this means, for magnetic fusion device, this means that we might have better particle confinement. Something very important. It also means that we have better control of the plasma over plasma rotation, which is important for control our plasma, which has effects on transport losses, especially on turbulent transport, as we will see on one of the later lectures, turbulent transport. And this is why it is so important in stellar radiator research to always try to regain or restore some kind of symmetry. Because I told you, when we bend a linear stellar radiator into a torus, we lose the symmetry. So this is why in stellar radiator research we try to regain or restore symmetry, such that we will have some type of quasi-symmetry in the end. So we have some type of quasi-symmetry. And I will show you a few examples in the next slide. What do these quasi-symmetry expressions in general mean? Well, it's the structure of the magnitude of B on the flux surface, which is important. So the structure of the magnetic field on the flux surface is the important quantity. This is decisive and not the symmetry in real space. This is something important to be aware of. And there's a nice paper by Ellen Boozer from 1983 where these things are discussed. So this is an important statement. And let's now have a look at a few of these quasi-symmetry cases. And here one example, the HS accelerator, which is an example for a quasi-helical symmetry. And the example shows the HS accelerator, a photography on the left-hand side, the magnetic field strength color-coded on the right-hand side. This stellarator is located at the University of Wisconsin-Madison in the US. And what does this quasi-helical symmetry means? It means that the magnetic field strength is approximately constant along a helical trajectory. And this means or has the effect that the experiment exhibits tokamak-like, meaning good transport properties and good neoclassical transport properties. Now the expression neoclassical just means that we have a toroidal magnetic field. And don't worry, we will discuss that in a future lecture, in one of the next videos actually. But neoclassical here just means that we have a toroidal magnetic field. And having a quasi-helical symmetry means we have tokamak-like neoclassical transport properties. And that is of particular importance for the confinement of fast particles, so of high energy particles. And of course, when we talk about high energy particles, we are always thinking about alpha particles. And we need the alpha particles to be well confined because we need them to deliver their energy to the plasma. And in a classical stellarator, these particles, as we will see, are very fast lost in the magnetic field. Okay, that was the HSX stellarator. Then another one is the quasi axisymmetry example. Okay, it's quasi axisymmetry. And this is again an experiment in the US. So the NCSX stellarator, which was, however, closed in 2008, immediately after the construction has been finished for a few reasons. In the drawing on the right hand side, there's first, well, it's first a drawing of the experiment. You can see it's quite a big stellarator because here you can see the typical engineer physicist standing next to it. It was built in at the Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory. On the right, a drawing of color-coded the magnetic field strength again. And here, quasi-axisymmetry means that we have a magnetic field being approximately constant along a toroidal coordinate. Along a toroidal coordinate. And similar to the previous example, this is predicted to have similar good confinement properties as in tokamaks. Unfortunately, this was never put into operation, as I said, due to a few problems during the construction phase, budget problems, and the magnetic field coils, there were a few problems. That's actually a long story. Another example is the so-called quasi-omnigeneous symmetry. So the quasi-omnigeneous, pretty sure I'm pronouncing it wrong, omnigeneous symmetry. And again, on the left-hand side, this is a study, so this is a model, so such a stellarator has not been built. This is a model, color-coded magnetic field strength. You can also see the coils there. And what this symmetry implies is that the displacement of the particle orbits from the flux surfaces is minimized. Now, you might be wondering why the particles deviate from the flux surfaces. As we will see in the following lecture, if you follow a particle around a tokamak or a stellarator, if you just follow it along its trajectory, you can see that due to drifts, the particle will locally deviate from the flux surfaces. And this is minimized in the quasi-omnigeneous symmetry. So the minimization of the displacement of particle orbits from the flux surfaces is what quasi-omnigeneous symmetry means. Now, it is actually in principle similar. It is in principle similar to W7X, which was drift optimized, so to reduce also losses by particles due to drifts, as we will discuss again, in a future lecture. So similar to W7X, with the difference, however, that the quasi-omnigeneous symmetry has a small aspect ratio. So it's more compact, it has a small aspect ratio. Oops, aspect ratio usually has no N there. Small aspect ratio, and also a significant bootstrap current. Now, the bootstrap current is a toroidal current flowing in the plasma, and W7, which is generated by the plasma itself. And actually, W7X was optimized to minimize the bootstrap current. But the quasi-omnigeneous concept has a significant bootstrap current, in contrast to a typical stellarator, where you do not have a strong toroidal current flowing. So overall, it is a much more compact design and an interesting candidate for a potential future experiment, let's say. And before we talk more about all the different type of stellarators that exist, I here have a nice drawing, and the major point is that various quasi and then whatever symmetry concepts exist, and it is not yet clear which is the best of those stellarators. So you can see in this drawing a few examples we talked about. So these are usually, no, these are all color-coded, the magnetic field strength. Here you can see W7AS, this is W7X. Then we have the TJ2 stellarator here, then LHD, Japan's largest stellarator, then NCSX, we talked about that, HSX, and then QPSS, which is only a study, and also Heliotron E and CHS. And you can see they look all quite different. So as I said, it is not yet clear which is the best stellarator. Okay, so that's it with video 12, where we talked again about stellarators. We talked briefly in the beginning about the difference between classical stellarator and Heliotron or torsatron. We talked about the advantage of a modular coil, of the modular coil concept, and that this was actually a big breakthrough, and how this is achieved, and mimicking the toroidal and helical field coils by modular coils. And then I told you a very important topic in stellarator research, which is the optimization of configurations for symmetry, and that the structure of the magnetic field on the flux surface is decisive and not the symmetry in real space. And we talked about a few examples, finishing with this kind of overview plot here, showing a few different stellarator concepts. And as I said, it's not yet clear which one of those is the best. That's it. Hope to see you in the next video.